Winston Churchill once said of Russia, "It is a riddle wrapped in a mystery inside an enigma." If he were alive today, Churchill might well have been speaking instead of the 1988 New York Mets. Who were the 1988 Mets? Were they the team that so convincingly won the National League East by 15 games? Or the team that lost the playoffs in seven tough games to the Los Angeles Dodgers? Were they the team that started the season with a 30-11 record? Or the team that played 500 ball throughout the long, hot summer? In the final analysis, the 1988 Mets were a successful team, a team that continued its five-year tradition of excellence, a team that met challenge after challenge and came up with 100 winning ways. The story of the 1988 New York Mets, sponsored by WFAN Sports Radio, 66 AM. The New York Mets began spring training 88 in a beautiful new state-of-the-art facility in Port St. Lucie, Florida. Sightseeing, however, soon gave way to hard work, as the 1988 Mets were clearly intent on making up for their disappointing second-place finish in 1987. This time, Dwight Gooden was with the team from the beginning. While Kevin Elster was hoping to live up to his shortstop of the future billing, the veterans, too, looked hungry and more than ready for the 1988 season. The first game of the 1988 National League season took place in Montreal, and after former Met and Expo legend Rusty Staub threw out the ceremonial first pitch, the Mets showed they were indeed ready for 88. Especially Dwight Gooden, who needed to prove he was capable of being the Dwight Gooden of old. And Kevin Elster, who just needed to prove he could play shortstop. Then there was Darryl Strawberry.
It's a high fly, hit deep to center, way back, going, going, gone!
The Mets hit a club record 6 homers in their 10-6 rout of the Expos, including one which nearly tore the roof off Olympic Stadium that came off the bat of Darryl Strawberry.
A high fly ball deep to right field, way up off the roof! It hit the roof! It hit the roof of Olympic Stadium, bounced down into right center field. It is a home run.
Not only was the home run barrage impressive to watch, it also got the Mets going in the right direction.
Yeah, I feel that, after last season, it was very important for us to come out of the box this year real quick. I think we had a lot of things to prove personally as well as the whole team. It's a funny thing about baseball. That's probably one of the reasons why, last year we had a lot of problems, a lot of injuries. Everybody expected us to repeat. I think we all had a lot of personal goals we had to come back and work a little harder for this year.
Deep to left. Gibson back. Out of here! Home run, Kevin Elster! I don't believe it!
Well, we felt that getting off to a quick start was very important to the ball club because the year before in 87, we had a lot of injuries. And after being there in 86, seeing what it was like, it makes you want to, scrive even harder and get back again. And so everybody just pulled together, got to know each other a lot better, work hard, puff each other on and off the field, and came together great as a team.
The expectations are so high, so a lot of times the pressure's so great. But coming out of shoot like we did, we didn't really play good the first week. But then we turned it on, the pitching and the hitting. We were averaging like 5 runs a game and ran up that great lead.
Swung on, hit in the air to left field. He got a pretty good ride. Palmeiro going back! Way back! Way back! Goodbye! Home run! The sucker's over!
We believed in ourselves, and we were able to come back. I think that showed that also to ourselves as well as everybody else that this is our year. And, you just gain confidence when those things happen.
Deep to center!
You gotta want to win, but not only do you have to want to win, you've got to have the talent there and the players there to be able to do it with.
Early on, the most talented of those players was clearly Darryl Strawberry. In fact, 1988 was definitely the year Darryl Strawberry came of age. He led the National League with 39 homers and drove in more than 100 runs for the second consecutive year as he finished second in the most valuable player balloting. Yes, Darryl became a team leader in 1988. a complete ball player who matured tremendously in his sixth major league season.
I think players get more comfortable after, you know, going around the league and experiencing the major leagues, and you start maturing. The key to my success is being very confident in myself and believing, you know, that I can put up some big numbers. I figured it was just a matter of time before things start happening.
Bottom of the 10th inning, and a drive to deep right field. It's going, going, it is gone, goodbye. And the Mets win it on Strawberry's two-run home run in the 10th inning.
Unfortunately, as great as Darryl was, he couldn't do it alone. And ultimately, the Mets couldn't maintain their blazing start. Beginning in June, they began a slump that would last nearly the entire summer.
I think it's probably one of the hottest summers that we have played in. And it might have had an effect on the overall statistics and averages of this year, you know, because they are way down in the National League. And I just don't think, I mean, all credit due to the pitchers wherever possible, but I don't think the pitchers improved that much over 1 year.
Whatever it was, the Mets struggled throughout the summer, and nowhere was that more in evidence than with Gary Carter's pursuit of his 300th home run, a quest that seemed so simple, yet seemed to go on forever. After hitting 8 homers in the first month and a half of the season, Carter went ice cold during a red-hot summer. And although there would be times when he'd come close, Gary would eventually go almost 3 months between homers. Add to that the disabling hamstring injury that Keith Hernandez suffered in early June, and you begin to see why the Mets had a problem. Keith wound up missing 2 full months, and with him out of the lineup and Carter slumping, the Mets had to look to others to help pick them up and get them going in the right direction. One of those others came through in a big way on June 21st. That night, Darryl Strawberry was walked intentionally to load the bases in a scoreless game against the Pittsburgh Pirates. The Pirates felt that Doug Drabeck could get past Kevin McReynolds, but McReynolds was ready for the challenge.
It's a drive! It's way back! It's gone! A grand slam home run by Kevin McReynolds!
By late June, it was apparent that the Pirates would be the team the Mets had to beat to win the East, so they simply went out and beat them.
We were still winning. We were still doing the things that we needed to do to keep us on top of the race. And I think that's the mark of a good ball club, that we can do whatever we need to win. We can win a game 13-10, 13-12, or we can win a game 1-0.
Against the Pirates, that's exactly what the Mets did. First, they took 2 out of 3 in New York, shutting out the Pirates 3-0 and 9-0. And then when the two teams moved to Pittsburgh a week later, the Mets took 2 out of 3 again.
Deep to left field is Elster. Back is Bonds. This ball is out of here. Home run, Kevin Elster.
After splitting the first two games, the Mets won the third dramatically after tying the game with 2 outs and 2 strikes in the ninth, courtesy of a Howard Johnson homer.
High and deep to right. Way back. Reynolds at the wall. Johnson ties the game.
I think it sent a message to that ball club that, you know, Pittsburgh is a good team, but you're just not ready yet, you know, to compete with us over long haul.
Grounder towards second. Tuffel. Elster. Quickly turned, double play, and the Mets win it. And I'll tell you, at year's end, they're going to point to this game as one of the key ball games of the year.
One of the key reasons the Mets were able to achieve 100 wins in 88 was Kevin McReynolds, who gave new meaning to the phrase, speak softly, but carry a big stick. In 1988, McReynolds not only hit 27 homers and drove in 99 runs, he also went the entire season without being thrown out stealing and led the National League with 2 grand slams, one of which came at Wrigley Field with 2 outs in the ninth and the Mets trailing the Chicago Cubs 7-5.
A high fly ball to center field. Webster going back. Grand slam, home run, Kevin McReynolds.
McReynolds just was doing his thing just consistently. You don't notice him being there. He's the best all-around player on the field. He plays defense, runs the bases. His instincts on the ball diamond are better than anybody on the ball club.
Nowhere was that more apparent than in left field, where McReynolds proved that he was more than just a good hitter. He played his position as well as anyone in the game, and his 18 assists was tops for an outfielder in the National League.
For me, it's all in the preparation of having my step down when I get the ball, getting rid of it in two steps or less. If you take three or four steps once you get to the ball, that gives the runner another couple of steps. And if you can cut it down to one or two steps, you've got a much greater chance of throwing a guy out. You know, the key to the game is to score more runs than the other team does. And one way you can keep the other team from scoring is with defense. And I take as much pride in my defense as I do in my hitting.
Whether he was throwing them out or hitting them out, by any standard, Kevin McReynolds had quite a year in 1988. The same could be said of the Mets pitching staff, which dominated the National League in 1988, returning to the form, which saw them lead the Mets to a World Championship in 1986.
The starters, we talked to them in the spring about let's complete more ball games. Let's be the kind of pitching staff that you cracked up to be in 86, you were hurt in 87, and let's do the things this year you're capable of.
In 1988, Dwight Gooden demonstrated that he was capable once again of becoming the workhorse of the staff, leading the team with 248 innings pitched while winning 18 games. Then there was Ron Darling, who finished the year with a career high of 17 wins and 4 shutouts. Sid Fernandez finished strong too. After losing 5 of his first 7, Sid completed 1988 with a 12-10 record and a 3.03 ERA. Bobby Ojeda also pitched well, finishing with 10 wins and a 2.88 ERA that included a team-high 5 shutouts. But the star of the staff was clearly David Cone, who became only the 4th Met in team history to win 20 games. What made Cone's remarkable 20-3 record even more amazing was that he didn't even become a starter until May 3rd.
Well, I kind of felt coming out of spring training that there was going to be a need for me to fill any type of role, be kind of a swing man, get a few spot starts, help out in middle relief, maybe a little bit of short relief to spell Roger and Randy. And that was my attitude, just help the club out in any way I can. And unfortunately for Rick Aguilera, you know, he had the elbow problem, and I stepped in, and I just wanted to take advantage of an opportunity.
He's just put it all together in a short period of time. It's one of the things that can happen, I think, with a pitcher. It usually doesn't happen with an everyday player. A pitcher can put everything together real quick and go from just a regular pitcher to becoming a star, and that's what David Cone has done.
A star, yes, and despite his baby face looks, a pitcher as tough as they come.
I think what really counts is what's down inside, the intensity and what you have, you know, as far as guts go, and that's something that doesn't come out in as far as physical appearance.
Of course, the Mets starters didn't do it alone in 88. Whenever Davey had to go to the bullpen usually came through. There was Rick Aguilera, who successfully came back from elbow surgery at the end of the season. And Terry Leach, who followed his spectacular 87 season by going 7-2 in 88. For short relief, there was Roger McDowell, who not only pitched well with 16 saves, but also pitched in with some comic relief.
He's a unique individual. He, you know, every day is something different, and you know, everybody kind of looks forward to what he's going to do next.
My main target usually is Bill Robinson. He's very easy to get. I remember one time earlier this year at the beginning of the season, I got him with a hot foot, and he made a bet with me that he would, or that I would never get him again through the course of the season. I got him the next night.
Those who know the Mets know McDowell's practical jokes don't stop at hot foots. This is a man with a virtual arsenal of props and gags. But in 88, Roger even tried something new to him, making home movies.
Hi, everybody. Sitting at home watching this movie. Bored out of your gourd, but having to be polite. Sit there and watch Roger Snake.
Randy Myers gave McDowell any competition when it came to being wacky, although their styles did differ somewhat. While McDowell was always loose as could be, Myers was as intense as they came.
He's different crazy than I am. He is crazy, military crazy. He's one person that you don't want to cross or play a practical joke on because he might get out one of those ninja stars and throw it at you and you're done.
My job is to get guys out. As a reliever or as a starter, you have a job to do, and I like to go about and try to do my job. I wasn't raised a loser, I was raised a winner, and I got to go out and every time go out and, you know, do the best I can. And you're going to make mistakes, but if you have a bad game, you got to get right back out there, and that's, you know, manager's job is to get you back out there.
In 1988, Myers got out there in 29 save opportunities and saved 26 of them, while finishing with a team-low ERA of 1.72, establishing himself along the way as the premier left-handed stopper in baseball. Excellent pitching has always been a Mets tradition. And on July the 24th, the team took time to honor Tom Seaver and retire the number of perhaps the greatest pitcher ever to wear a Met uniform.
I'm going to say thank you in my own very special way. And if you know me, how much I love pitching, you'll know what it means to me.
What a wonderful way to link the past with the present. And in the process, celebrate a tradition of excellence that has marked the franchise with baseball's winningest ways of the past 5 years.
Why couldn't? Has set a new major league record for strikeouts by a rookie pitcher.
Curve, well hit, deep to left field, way back, it may go. It is at the top of the wall, gone, a home run. Gary Carter wins it. Now the pitch on the way, he struck him out. The Mets have won the World Series, and they're crowd jamming and crowding all over Jesse Orozco.
Errol Strawberry, a member of the 30-30 Club. He becomes the ninth man to join that exclusive club, and he joins Howard Johnson of the Mets.
They now have set a club record. They've set a major league record for the most home runs hit by a team on opening day.
Over the years, Shea Stadium has been the home of many memorable moments. And now celebrating its 25th anniversary, Shea never looked better. And down the stretch in 88, neither did the Mets. When their lead over the Pirates dwindled to just a few games in August, the Mets simply beat Pittsburgh in 6 of 8 crucial games, one of which saw Keith Hernandez return to action.
3-0 pitch hit deep to right field. It is gone. Goodbye. Keith Hernandez, welcome back.
August also saw the end of Gary Carter's quest for his 300th home run, which came on August 11th at Wrigley Field.
I come across home plate. Howard Johnson was on the on-deck circle, and he had this big smile, like he was having a heart attack. And I kind of went the same way, and it was just a big relief. And fortunately, the fan was coaxed into throwing it back on the field, so I have that proud souvenir of my 300th home run.
With Pittsburgh put away, the Mets faced a final challenge from the Montreal Expos, but the Mets had an answer for them, too.
And he drives one. But here comes Martinez. He makes the catch. Here comes Johnson and the throw. He wins the game. Johnson scores, and the Mets win it 4-3.
Never during the season have we relied on anybody else to fight our battles. Whenever Pittsburgh challenged us, we beat them head-to-head. When Montreal challenged us, we beat them. Since that point, we never looked back.
From that point on, the Mets got hot again, winning 30 of their last 42, showing the dominance they displayed for so much of the early part of the season.
We rose to the occasion. We got hot in late August in Los Angeles. We swept LA. And like, you know, whenever there's a tight pennant race, the team that wins in September within the division is the team that wins it, and we certainly had a great September, so I got to feel that we rose to the occasion.
Change up hit deep to right. Back is Kruk. This ball is out of here. Home run, Keith Hernandez. 4-0, New York.
All good clubs finish strong, and generally it's picked up in August. We didn't really pick it up in August. We were kind of a 500 club in August, and I think we had to win 4 or 5 games at the end of August to be a 500 club, or a little better than 500 club in August. September was the month where really the pitching and everything came together.
Swung on deep to right field. Dawson to the wall.
Our pitchers has kept us there all year. We have to give them the credit for keeping us right in the middle of that pennant race. And then when the offense got rolling in September, it just, you know, really picked up everything that we were missing. And then Greg Jeffries came up and he, you know, played a big part of it, you know, getting the offense going, hitting the number two spot, where he made more opportunities happen for me and Keith. And I think that made a big difference how the offense turned around.
It's doubtful that any rookie in the history of the Mets franchise made as much of an immediate impact as Greg Jeffries. After just 2 weeks in the majors, Jeffries was named the National League's Player of the Week and was already showing the veterans a thing or two.
Get deep to left field, way back, and this ball is out of here. Home run, Greg Jeffries.
I just always try to hustle. That's all I want to do. I want to put in 110%, and I just... I feel I need to do that to be a decent player. If I kind of be lackadaisical, I feel I'm gonna make a lot of mistakes. So I just try to hustle as much as I can. It's just the way I'm brought up, just hustling, and I play at a high level intensity, and it's in my genes, I guess. I don't really know how to explain it, but I just play with a lot of hustle.
A lot of hustle might be an understatement. Jeffries sparked a fire under the Mets that really got them going, and by late September, the race with the Pirates and the Expos was all but over. But before the Mets could clinch the division, misfortune struck. Bobby Ojeda severely cut a finger on his pitching hand and was forced to miss the rest of the season. Ojeda's injury was still fresh in everyone's mind when the night came for the Mets to clinch their second National League Eastern Division title in 3 years. That happened on September 22nd. And although the feeling of exuberance was tempered, there was still plenty of it going around.
He gave it to him. Strike three, ball game over. New York Mets win the National League Eastern Division crown, the second time in 3 years.
So it was on to the National League playoffs, where the heavily favored Mets would face the Los Angeles Dodgers. In Game 1, the Dodgers sent Oral Hershiser to the mound, and as he had done in his previous 59 innings, Hershiser held the Mets scoreless into the ninth. Fortunately, Dwight Gooden was pitching as well as Hershiser. Still, the Dodgers led 2-0 until one out in the ninth when the Mets finally got something going.
And it's a line drive base hit going into right center field. Jeffries around third is scoring, and
Soon Hershiser was gone, and for the Dodgers, so was the game.
Short center field, coming quickly, Shelby diving, can't get it. Here's the throw, coming to the plate. A collision at the plate, the run is in. Mets have the lead. Mets have the lead.
Things, however, didn't go so well in game two. David Cohn was hit early and often. And on this night, there would be no miracle finish as the Dodgers held on for a 6-3 win. So the series shifted to Shea for game three, and while the weather wasn't so great, at least the game was. Fantastic plays and controversy marked the afternoon as the Mets scored 5 times in the 8th for another come-from-behind win. Ultimately, the Mets' magic would end in game 4. After falling behind 2-0 in the first, Darryl Strawberry tied the game with a 2-run homer in the 4th. One batter later, Kevin McReynolds followed with a homer of his own, and the Mets had a 3-2 lead, which they eventually increased to 4-2 going into the 9th. The Mets looked to be a lock to go up 3 games to 1 in the series, especially with Gooden cruising on the mound, not having given up a hit since the first. But John Shelby worked out a walk after falling behind in the count 0-2. And then Mike Socha delivered the blow that would ultimately cripple the Mets.
Well hit drive deep to right field, way back. It may go out of here. It's gone. It's gone. The game is tied up. The Dodgers have tied it up.
Mike Socha's dramatic 2-run homer sent the game into extra innings, where Kirk Gibson's homer in the 12th won it. Less than 14 hours later, Los Angeles won big again. David Cohn redeemed himself by winning Game 6 in Los Angeles as the Mets cruised to a 5-1 win. But in Game 7, the Mets would be shut out by the incomparable Hershiser. A season that held so much promise was surprisingly and abruptly over. In the final analysis, how could you sum up 1988? By most accounts, it was a very successful year. A year of winning, a year of memories, and a year of milestones. Darryl Strawberry became the Mets' all-time home run leader, and Dwight Gooden recorded the 1,000th strikeout of his young but already brilliant career. Mookie Wilson came away with career hit 1,000 and also became the Mets' all-time leader in runs scored. Then there was Gary Carter's 300th home run, hit during his 12th straight year of catching more than 100 games, just one season short of the Major League record. And how about David Cohn, whose 20-3 record ranked as the 6th best in baseball history for pitchers with 20 or more wins in a season. And finally, let's not forget the 3 million-plus fans who poured into Shea to witness it all, including the 5th straight season in which Davey Johnson won more than 90 games. Yes, the Mets came within 1 game of going to the World Series and missed, and that hurt. But it was also a team which proved it could win again and again and again, and will be a winner again in 1989 as the Mets' tradition of excellence continues.
If I had to be one other person for a season, I'd probably like to be Darryl Strawberry.
David Cohn.
Why?
He's got a great future, and I wouldn't want to come back as a hitter. I'd want to try as a pitcher.
Really?
Yeah. I just rather try as a pitcher, starting pitcher. I think it'd be fun. Have 4 days off in between. Can relax, not play every day. I think it'd be sweet.
One of the millionaires. One of the 20 millionaires in this team I'd like to be.
I'll say Darryl.
just you know, the way he hits the ball. And coming up as a kid, I always wanted to be a hitter. And just to, you know, hit 30 home runs plus a year and try to run the bases would be great.
I've never caught, except in, you know, real little league, and that doesn't count. And I think it would be interesting to go back there with the mask and the protector and the shin guards and see what it's all about and try not to blink when the guy swings.
To me, I think Mookie Wilson is probably the greatest Mets player ever played, so I don't think it'd be anyone else. But if I had to, for the sake of argument, if I had to be another ball player, I would have to say I would like to be Daryl Strawberry.
I probably would want to be Davey Johnson, the manager, because I think he's sitting in a good situation where, you know, he's probably the winningest manager over the last 5 years. So I would like to be in a situation like Davey Johnson at this particular point.
Well, you know, I know them all, and if I could be one other guy, I wouldn't pick any of them.
New York's most entertaining sports team has moved to 66 on your AM dial.
I'm Mr. LeBorny, WFAN.
Hi, Miss. You don't know anything about sports. Why don't you get off the radio?
Oh, hi, Pete. Pete Franklin, afternoons here at WFAN.
Great. You don't know a pickoff from a kickoff, a bunt from a punt. The Mets from the Jets.
Oh, yeah. Well, ask my close personal friend, Daryl Raspberry.
Raspberry, it's strawberry dumb.
You don't have to be a sports nut to enjoy New York's most entertaining sports team on the new Sports Radio 66 AM, WFAN.
Out there in the club.